just talk about where I started from, because I'm keen to ensure that aviculture continues and that we get more young people into aviculture. So I always reflect back on why I started keeping birds. That's my first aviary when I was 9. And I was stimulated to keep birds by my grandmother, who had budgies and canaries and fish and tortoises. And so she gave me my first budgies, and then I got into finches, and I've kept finches ever since. So I think you should all think about why you started keeping birds, and think about what you're doing to get someone else to get into aviculture. Otherwise, it's going to die. That's me and my little brother building my aviaries. I filled up our backyard with aviaries when I was young. This is my current main set of breeding aviaries, 10 aviaries. I've got 3 biggish ones on this end. They're all 9 metres by 3, and then 7 6x1s. I've got another bank of aviaries up the back now as well, but this is my main aviary set. Fairly standard for Australian aviaries, open flights. Some people like fully roofed flights. I've never had fully roofed flights, but and I've got a walkway at the back. It means I can look after the birds no matter what the weather's doing, and do everything down there. So I haven't got a bed down there yet. I could.
Good kitchen though.
Fridge and freezer, kitchen,
nice
sink and everything.
But different from what I have here.
I've got all the water for everything is automatic, and I've got some small holding cages with these types of automatic waterers. But I wasn't going to talk too much about the aviaries, but that's what that aviary complex looked like when it was recently built. And that's what it looks like, well, not now, because those front trees have grown up that much, you can't see it. But I was going to talk mostly about nutrition and just think about what we have to provide to have effective nutrition. So there's a whole class of nutrients, proteins, carbohydrates, fats, fibre, vitamins and minerals, and various trace elements that might be present in a mineral mix. Getting the right balance of all of those and providing the right balance at the right time during a breeding season and a non-breeding season is what we can control by controlling our diet. Obviously the base diet for finches is dry seed, but that's only ever a maintenance diet, except perhaps for things like zebras. They'll breed on just about anything, floor sweepings. But the basic seeds that I use are those 5. I buy all single seeds and mix my own mixes. Sometimes I feed single seeds, and Cheryl, my partner, she's got a couple of aviaries of her own too. She's, as I said before, we're doing this project on every Australian species, and so she's collecting information on preferences. So all her seeds are fed separately, and she measures consumption for everything. I just haven't got time, but essentially dry seeds are a carbohydrate source, so they're providing energy but not much else. Some protein, canary seed has some protein, but none of the protein levels there are sufficient for rearing young birds in particular.
Are those seeds, they're not like our imported ones, all heat treated and destroyed either?
No, these are nice live seeds.
Yeah.
Another element, basic element, obviously, is grits and minerals. And just to show you the grit mix that I use, it's I mix various things. So obviously fine shell grit, but I mix in with that a suite of other things. So PVM powder or pink powder, pigeon vitamin mix powder, Biocal, which is a formulated blend of 4 different sources of calcium. They have different capacities to be metabolized by birds. Crumbled mineral block, and I used to put my crushed eggshell in my grit mix, but I don't now. I feed that separate. But essentially I mix that up, and I also add diatomaceous earth to my grit mix these days. So there's some of the things that I put in my grit mix, and we feed charcoal all the time. So charcoal and eggshell are fed separately. We feed cuttlefish as well.
What's the diatomaceous earth for? What is that? Is it just minerals or something?
Well, diatomaceous earth is...
it's a cleanser.
Yeah, it has some benefits for the gut.
Yeah.
Like what?
It can help clear parasites from the gut, for example. So essentially diatomaceous earth is very fine fossilised shells. A lot of people take diatomaceous earth in water every morning. It's a bit contentious at the moment whether it's got a huge benefit or not, but it certainly doesn't hurt the birds.
So it's not really earth then, it's made from shells, so is it?
It's
not dirt, really? I was thinking it was dirt.
It's not dirt. It's fossilised micro shells that's been compacted into a rock.
Okay.
And it's a very fine powder.
Very fine. Well, and it comes in various forms. So there's food-grade diatomaceous earth, which is the only one you'd use for birds.
Yeah.
There's also diatomaceous earth that's used in filters for
food. So say cleansing or cleaning, yeah.
You don't use that one. That'll kill birds.
Yeah. Mm. It's good to know, though, because if people don't know, they will.
Yeah.
How do you feed it, Gary? Do you mix it
in my grit.
Yeah, okay.
Yeah.
It's supposed to be kill a worm attack.
It's a bit of a worm.
Yeah, and it will, like diatomaceous earth mixed into your seed, will kill any insects in the seed.
That's
that is diatomaceous earth, top grade.
Yeah.
We put it in our soft food, amongst other things.
But you don't eat it, do you?
Yeah.
Do we
eat it?
I mean, Bev probably puts it in everything.
It's in the Bill and Bev put it in their soft food.
Yeah.
Lovely.
It's got all different.
I'll just take a shot of it.
Do you want to take a bit home?
No, I just wanted to show everybody that could be watching this. It's not live.
Scoop
this,
it out and wrap
video.
It up if you want to take some home.
I've got to go and research this first, Bill. I've got to research it myself.
Okay,
so
there's quite a bit of literature.
Yeah.
Just to go through the various nutrients I provide, I'll just show you my daily feed. So that's tray that my aviaries would get, each aviary would get each day. And so we'll just start with, not with these ones, we'll start with the small seed mix. So I feed, as I said, the standard dry millets and things, but I also feed a blend of as many different grass seeds as I can get hold of. Just small, fine grass seeds, so phalaris is in there, that you know, Bambatsi panic, signal grass, carpet grass. From time to time it varies depending on what I can get.
Your niger is Australian grown now.
Australian niger,
which gives you a great advantage.
Yeah.
You know, what we get is so treated, it's more or less very.
Yeah, well, ours sprouts really, really nicely for our siskins. And yeah, there are other things that whenever I can get them. So I just buy as many of those and mix it up in a small seed mix.
Mm.
And each aviary gets a small quantity. And the birds really enjoy all of those.
Mm.
It depends on the species. Some species really love signal grass. The siskins obviously like the niger. For siskins I feed niger separately, but I think they get real value. There's different types of minerals in those grasses and just a bit of interest as well. So a diversity of nutrients, and that's how it's fed. Or one of these little ones. So they don't get large quantity. We use red millet treated with oils. So it's like in the past, people use cod liver oil a lot and wheat germ oil. We just use breeding aid or good oil now, which is a blend of plant and fish oils. We find all of our birds just love that. So breeding aid is a great source of vitamins A and D3 and E. And then a suite of oils that have significant benefits. I think it has significant benefits for egg binding, for example.
Mm-hmm.
But we mix 20 mils in a kilo, and we'd use about a kilo every 2 days with our birds.
A kilo?
Gosh.
Yeah.
You see how many bird types he's got?
yeah, that's right.
So every aviary gets a dish like that each day. Some of them get a bit more, depends on the species. Things like Picturellas, they'll eat just about only that. It's extraordinary. Then we've got a soft food. So our soft food is it's something that evolves. So I'm sure all of you have got different soft food blends, and from year to year they change as you hear up what other people do. Most finches benefit from soft food. There's all sorts of recipes. My soft food is based on, or starts on, either sprouted seed or frozen milk seed. So we've got an advantage that we can buy seed. It's French white millet that's harvested when it's at the milky stage, so half ripe. So it's not in sprays, it's actually harvested seed at that stage, and there's only one grower that grows it. Pain in the bum to harvest, as you can imagine, but it's snap frozen within 30 minutes of harvest, and we can buy a year's supply, and it's hugely more nutritious than sprouted seed, and much more nutritious than dry seed, of course. So that's the base of my soft food, but then I mix in various supplements from time to time, different vegetables and greens, and vitamins and mineral supplements. But as I said, my soft food, and I'm sure yours, evolves all the time as new things come along. Some time ago, I used to blend up this sort of a soft food, which was Mike Fiddler's Complete Soft Food, with peas, corn and carrot, with turkey starter crumbles, was my base soft food, and then I'd mix that in with equal parts of frozen red millet at the milk stage and frozen French white and some tonic seed, and that was my soft food. But it then evolved to be, again, frozen green seed. I'd use a bit of finch crumbles, a bit of Livermore, a bit of vitamin powder, a bit of liquid calcium. So it evolved to that. Then I stopped using liquid calcium. No egg in that one, no. But then I started, like I mentioned before, the Naturally for Birds supplements. So Prima and Protein Boost have a significant component of that is egg powder. So whole egg powder. So now my soft food is based on those. So I've dropped out Livermore and Finch Crumbles and Solvata, because all of these things are in those supplements. And so I use now micronutrients and Prima blended in with frozen green seed, so it's much simpler. And I've already gone through all this last time, so I won't bore you with it again. But it makes it simpler. In terms of nutritional value, essentially the end product is similar to what Bill and Bev do, but it's much easier to make up. So then live food. Most of my finches enjoy live food. It's not essential for all of them, but for some of them it certainly is essential. And so I use a lot of live food. There's lots of forms of live food. I know some people try to avoid live food, and you could use some supplements in place of live food if you can get the protein levels high enough. But for the time being, I'm providing live food. We breed all our own. We're lucky to have built a controlled environment room to breed my live food in. And we breed maggots, so it's bushfly maggots, mealworms and crickets. That's
no termites. Are you not anywhere near termites?
No, I haven't got time to go collecting termites. So live food, I can do all the work at night, and I haven't got time to collect termites. But termites are the best live food if you can get them. That's my controlled environment room. I just built it in the corner of the carport.
As you do.
So that's inside. It's only 2.4 cubed, made out of
polypanel?
Cool room panel,
yeah.
Obviously.
Mm-hmm.
With an air conditioner to hold it at 28 degrees, and we've got a dehumidifier to keep the humidity below 50%. But in there, we've got our fly cages where we breed the maggots. We've got our cricket breeding boxes, and crickets are an absolute snack to breed. They're probably the easiest of the lot. Well, maggots are easy. And then we've got mealworms, which are easy but slow. So we can breed all three of them in there. The advantage of live food, of course, is the high protein that you can provide that you really need for developing young birds. Some of them have disadvantages, and one of the real disadvantages of mealworms is that the calcium-phosphorus ratio of mealworms is exactly the opposite for what you want for birds. You need a ratio of about 2-1, and mealworms are terrible from that point of view, and quite high in fat. So I would never actually use mealworms as my sole live food. But if you're providing other protein sources, it's probably fine. But these are the three that I use now. Just quickly, how to breed them. Does anybody here breed live food?
Yeah.
Yep. So bush fly maggots, very easy. They go through a full life cycle. They're a holometabolist, which means they go through a full metamorphosis. Eggs, three instars of larvae, a pupal stage, and then a fly. Very easy to feed. Like for rearing them and collecting eggs, I use I actually use pollard now rather than bran. Pollard, milk powder, water. For the adults, all you need is some sugar and some water. And this is how I collect eggs in butter containers. I use AviCleanse in the water just to keep it clean and sweet. And I use these dental rolls for the flies to drink from. So it avoids drowning lots of flies and making a mess.
Put a reaction out the top.
Sorry?
Yeah. Put a reaction out the top.
Yeah. So I put normally two of these in each of my fly boxes, leave them for 2 days. By the time I pull them out, the maggots have hatched. I then tip them into a larger round plastic container. That's as much so that the maggots can get access to the full volume of the food. They don't like going too deep, and you don't get enough air if you just leave them in those containers.
How many days from you putting a fresh batch in into your fly box, how many days until you feed them out? Your fly might be a little bit different than our one.
Yeah, about 5 days.
That's the same. I mean,
yeah.
I probably feed mine.
So I tip them out at 2 days and usually feed them again.
Yeah.
And then by 3 days later, they're at this stage where just a few are starting to pupate. All the others, before they pupate, they evacuate their gut. So they're nice and clean, and I can then store these in the refrigerator or feed them straight out. I sieve a bit of the leftover food out, but I certainly don't remove it all.
How long do they stay or carry in the fridge for?
At least a couple of weeks. Beyond that, they might get a bit...
So they're still alive, they still come back to life?
Oh yeah, they're still alive, yeah. And you can freeze them.
Yeah? They wouldn't come back to life though when you've...
No, no, they're dead. But like in Europe, that's what they use, is frozen maggots. And once you get birds onto frozen maggots, it's again much more convenient as well. That's the sort of fly boxes I use. So obviously you've got to keep them in a fly-proof cage, and I put rings on my flies.
Sure you do.
So when the neighbours complain, no, it's not mine.
That's right. Yeah.
Or it is your one, as the case may be.
The breeding flies is, as I said, it's really easy once you get into a routine. Control temperature some way or other, but get into a consistent routine, and don't forget to put pupae back in your fly boxes or you'll run out of flies very quick.
What temperature do you run yours at?
28.
28.
Mealworms, again, very easy but slow, so it can take from, I let my beetles lay for a week and then sift them out, put them in a new tray, and from that point to when they're ready to feed is about 7 weeks. But I do four trays at a time. Four trays last me a week, and they can be about a kilo per tray, so that's what I'm using per week. They again go through a full life cycle with the pupal stage, and the beetles are very easy to look after. They need some sort of base, so I use normally bran. I sterilise the bran by microwaving it to get rid of little, there's a brown mite that can erupt in bran if you're not careful. I use dog biscuits, chick starter crumbles and carrots for moisture, and as I said, they're a bit, they just take time, but if you've got enough space, you can produce significant quantities of mealworms very easily. Then house crickets, it's a little different in that it doesn't go through a pupal stage, so they're called hemimetabolous. They just go from egg to nymph, and then the nymphs just molt and get bigger. And by the time they get wings, they're adults and start breeding. These house crickets don't fly. They're very easy to contain, just in big plastic tubs. And I just provide them with somewhere to hide, oops, in egg cartons. We feed them either high protein cat pellets that have been milled, or we can now buy a cricket mash that one of the commercial producers of crickets uses. They need some sort of green plant material for to get access to sterols, so we use lettuce. They don't like high humidity, so that's why we keep the humidity below 50%, and then you've got to collect eggs from them, which is quite easy. So we use cos lettuce, somewhere to hide. When they just hatch, and you know the hatchlings are just tiny little back specks, we just use lettuce for moisture, because if you give them an open water container, they just drown themselves. But once they get bigger, usually at about 4 to 5 days, we use just a standard drinker, again with a cotton roll, so that they don't drown themselves. Even big crickets will drown themselves in open water. But these work very effectively. Their food.
So where do they lay the eggs on?
Yeah. I don't know if I've got a photo of where they lay their eggs. I probably haven't. What I use is Chinese takeaway food containers, mm-hmm. about so deep,
yep.
filled with vermiculite, the finest grade you can get, number one grade vermiculite.
What the hell's that?
What's vermiculite?
It's just it's something that people use in potting mix.
Mm-hmm.
So it holds moisture.
Oh, okay.
You can buy a bag like that.
Is it like
number
cat
one
litter?
Grade vermiculite?
Is it like cat litter?
No, nothing like cat litter.
Yeah, well,
I don't know how to describe it.
Is it white in colour?
The one I get is white, or you can get it that sort of browny, silvery colour.
Yeah.
So I just put vermiculite in those trays, and then you just saturate it with water so that it's absolutely saturated. Leave it sit for about 4 hours, and it will absorb nearly all that water. Then you have to put a fly gauze cover over the top, and then put it in with a tub of adult crickets, and the females lay through the wire into the vermiculite. If you don't have the wire, the males will come in and eat the eggs.
Oh, okay.
So they just dig the eggs up. But the females will lay thousands of eggs in a tray like that. I leave them for a week, take them out, and 13 days later they will hatch. And so I normally run 4 or 5 tubs of adults, and that produces me thousands of young crickets. That's the sort of size that I feed them. So they're about a centimetre long. But depending on the species, you can feed them much bigger than that. Some species like picturellas will go berserk on that size, but you can give them adult crickets and they'll rip them to bits. Mm-hmm. They really love them. You can see their picturellas getting into their crickets.
Beautiful, aren't they?
So that's live food. I feed leafy green vegetables either in my daily feed tray or just separate greens. At this time of year, we're feeding a lot of chickweed. During the summer, when there's no chickweed growing, it's various leafy green vegetables that I buy and chop up. So there's all sorts of things. We grow chicory and plantain in pots and use that, and just buy in endive and other things. Hugely valuable source of minerals and vitamins and carotenoids in particular. But the like that micronutrients is a great source of carotenoids as well. So they get that. We feed Lebanese cucumber. Every aviary gets a piece every day.
Do you use
like that.
Telegraph cucumber as an alternative? Bigger and cheaper?
Yeah, I stick to Lebanese cucumber.
What do you pay for a Lebanese cucumber?
Yeah, they're quite dear here, you know.
Is it?
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
Okay.
It's like trying to buy a mango here. It's like
$5 for a Telegram cucumber at the moment anyway.
Yeah, they're all dear.
Telegraph cucumber is much bigger.
Much bigger.
Yeah. And they seem to like it just
Well, they're
very similar, I think.
Lebanese, we can normally buy for about $4 a kilo.
Oh, wow. I forgot how cheap it is to buy veggies and fruit.
The birds love it anyway. Then in aviaries with siskins, they're getting crushed sunflower, niger and canola, and sprouted niger, canola, and clover.
Is that because they need that oil? They need the higher fat?
Particularly when, siskins need access to niger and crushed sunflower, dry.
Yeah.
But when they're feeding young ones, they really go for the sprouted. So I just mix equal parts of niger, canola, and clover seed, and it sprouts very readily. And it's mostly siskins that take that. Blue-faced parrot finches will take some because they just eat everything. And golden song sparrows will take that mix as well. And, well, there it is there. It depends, like, I don't actually use white lettuce anymore. All our sprouted seed, I soak in water with Vercon-S to sterilise it. I don't do all this rinsing every X hours. It might get rinsed once at the end, but with Vercon, I've found it fine. I've been using that for 20 years now. Whenever we can, the birds getting seeding grasses, so we're lucky to have things like green panic growing in our garden. We've got a few acres. And
can you stop there a second? That seed there is about the size of the rye I was telling you about, and if you can find plenty of that, they love it. Sorry.
Yeah.
Thanks.
Signal grass is another one that lots of species like. It's got larger seeds on these very distinctive heads.
Don't we grow that here?
I think I've seen a plant like that.
It's
in my lawn.
I think. Yeah. Isn't that
paspalum? No, it's not paspalum.
No. Different family.
But I just thought that the our paspalum looked a bit like that.
Yeah, but
similar.
It's essentially gone feral in Australia, so we can get it. You can buy the seeds dry, but lots of things like the seed heads. We use Russian comfrey, and I noticed in your handbook you've got comfrey.
Mm-hmm.
Not many people in Australia use it, and it's it's a really interesting plant. We don't need to go through all the details, but really rich in secondary compounds, particularly I'll get to it in a minute. I just can't think of the class of compounds. Anyway, it's been used by man for a long time because it has the property of helping to knit broken bones. It's got a particular compound called allantoin.
Give me some.
Very rich in nitrogen. Widely used as herbal medicine. It's known as nitbone is its common name. That's where the specific name, the genus name comes from. It's got allantoin that helps with cell growth and repair. But really rich in pyrrolizidine alkaloids, which can be hugely toxic at high concentrations, but hugely therapeutic at low concentrations. And so it's a plant that you wouldn't want to be consuming huge amounts of, but most of the alkaloids are in the roots rather than the leaves. But it's always been controversial. Lots of Americans just about killed themselves with comfrey teas because they were consuming way too much and it was banned for use. Lots of bird people stopped using it because they said, oh, it'll kill your birds. Well, it doesn't kill your birds. We don't need to go through all this detail. It's very valuable in terms of minerals, high protein, and lots of vitamins. So, and lots of birds love it. So our siskins love it. With siskins, we can't grow comfrey in the aviary because they just destroy the plants. We have to put it in pots. Double bars, nibble a bit. Picturellas. In the aviaries where we've got picturellas, we do grow it, and they just nibble little bits out of the leaf. But every morning, they go down and just take a little therapeutic bite of comfrey leaf. Surprises to me, when we gave yellow rumps access to it, they didn't touch it. I don't really understand that. And golden song sparrows, you don't have them over here, do you?
No.
So that's the sort of pot that I would put in an aviary with golden song sparrows and leave it in for 24 hours and it looks like
oh
that.
Oh my goodness.
So and then I just take it out and let it regenerate. And I only give them access to that once every couple of weeks. It's not daily.
No, it's okay.
We also use saltbush.
So can we just go back to the comfrey? You said Russian.
Yeah,
it has to be that one, doesn't it? Because there's quite a few different.
Yeah, you can buy, like, Russian comfrey is a hybrid.
I'm not quite sure which one we get over here.
Yeah, you can buy just normal comfrey.
Yeah.
Which is Symphytum uplandicum. It has much higher levels of alkaloids than Russian comfrey does. But most of it's in the root.
Okay.
So the leaves are still fine. Yeah, we won't go back to all that. The Russian comfrey is the one that most bird people use. When I was a kid, all the canary breeders used comfrey for their canaries.
Everybody else
one? Yeah. So saltbush, we grow for the birds, and most birds will take that, but particularly gouldians, siskins, parrot finches. They become so tame, so that's Cheryl, when she had gouldians, they just come down and land on the saltbush each morning.
Oh.
To get their saltbush. The young ones. We collect these small sunflower heads, particularly for the siskins, but parrot finches will take them. So I just collect them during the summer and freeze them. And the siskins, when they're breeding, they'll demolish one of those a day. So we use either. This is actual feral sunflowers. We can find around our streets Mexican sunflower, which is a weed. But much the same, we harvest them after all the petals have fallen off. By that stage, the seed is set but still soft, and just freeze them. And the birds really enjoy getting in and pulling the seeds out. Okay, so that's what I do, and often when I give this talk, people say, why do you have, do they really need all that stuff? And I say, well, we're in aviculture, our birds are not getting access to everything they might choose in the wild. In the wild, they can have a much wider and diverse diet than we can ever provide. There's a lot of studies of finches in the wild. And I know I talked before about gouldians, that when they're breeding only feed on one thing. But that's unusual. Most finches feed on all sorts of things. There's studies of diamonds that showed they were consuming seeds of 44 different species of plants that they could identify, and another 36 species they couldn't. There's similar studies of some double bars and red brows that shows a similar broad range of species they're harvesting. And so I just try to simulate as much diversity as I can and allow the birds to choose what they want from their diet. So, oh, it's just repeating the same thing. So that's all I was going to say. I've just got to end. So these are the species I keep at the moment. I really like Australian species, and pictorellas and diamonds are my favourites. We're doing a lot of work with masks at the moment, particularly white ears, getting them going. But most of the Australians accept the beautifuls and red ears at the moment, and a suite of foreign species. And just to finish off, there's just some images, again, Cheryl's images of some of the finches.
Those are all in the finches.
I think we've got a variety of it, haven't we, Bob? I remember seeing
we
it.
We thought
in the
we'd
nursery.
Found it and we tried it on the birds and they wouldn't look at it, so presumably it wasn't the right plant.
The right sort.
It looked very similar.
Yeah, it
does. Gary, you mentioned charcoal.
Yep.
That you always have. And what sort of charcoal is it? I mean, is it stuff you buy or do you make special hardwood or what?
You can buy charcoal. Some people, though, that produce it commercially, it's they burn it too far and it's just solid little hard stones of charcoal.
Mm.
You need
you
to be able to powder it.
So you powder
so,
it.
So there's one supplier I used to buy it from, but these days we just collect burnt timber in the bush and powder it ourselves.
Uh-huh.
So you have to be careful you're not getting treated timbers and things.
Yes, indeed. We use Pumanix.
Yes,
which is basically the same thing.
You
use what's that?
Pumanix.
The patient and people develop it. It's got more than just charcoal.
It's a mix, is it?
Yeah. So every single species I've got hoes into it, especially the Gordian.
Yeah, that's the same Gordian. Mask, go berserk on charcoal.
And
where
do you get that from?
Gordians will put them in the nest, won't they?
Yeah.
In the nest.
Yeah, Plymouth.
Oh, yeah.
Picturellas do a similar thing with cuttlefish.
Yeah.
If you cut cuttlefish in little bits and give it to picturellas, they'll take it straight to their nest.
Have you got your email address on the
tag? Yeah,
Oh, email.
Yeah. Oh, thanks, Ed. Yeah.
Okay. You just buy the bag that they get.
Oh, right.
I've used it for
years.
No, we get, we were buying for the club, we were buying, you get them in boxes of six.
Six boxes in a box.
Six boxes of six.
Gary?
What's it called?
It's from Auckland.
Pimenex.
Okay. Gary, I've got, sorry, just had a question from Dylan. One of our members wanted to know about the silver bill, how you brought them back and whether we could learn something about that in our, diminishing birds. And how it was done.
We did it essentially... We controlled the whole process. So we started off by getting birds and pairs from the last few sources we could find. And then I started off as the foundation breeder. So I started off with, I think we had six different lines of silverbills, and I bred them for three nests and then started farming pairs, multiple pairs out to volunteer breeders. So I had the foundation stock, and by that time you could only find odd birds here and there, like they had just about gone.
Hmm.
So we probably didn't start with as many as we'd like. And then I bred enough to start three more breeders. They all got two pairs each, and I controlled the pairings, so I knew who I was pairing with whom. All the birds were DNA sexed. So three breeders got two pairs each, then they would breed birds and all the young ones came back to me.
Mm-hmm.
I would DNA the lot, make up new pairings and then
yep,
get more breeders. And we just kept doing that until we got up to 72 volunteer breeders all over the country. By that time, we then got them, we said, well, you can keep 20% of what you breed, and 80% came back. And we then had got to the point where we'd bred almost 1,000 birds.
How long?
And we just, sorry?
Was that, how long was that, 5 years?
5 years that took. And then we terminated, and all the breeders that had birds at that time were allowed to keep them. And all the birds that had come back to me, I then sold. And that went into our conservation fund at QFS. And we just tried to get them as widely spread around the country as we could, with multiple people with two or three pairs, and with bloodlines that we tried to control so that we didn't have too many sibling matings and things going on.
Did you need to coordinate with other finch clubs around Australia, or did you? How did you get...
No, we did it through our QFS membership, because they're all over Australia.
Mm-hmm.
But they went to every state except Tasmania and Western Australia.
Yeah.
And yeah, so we got up to that sort of number. And like, we run a finch census every 3 years, so we're able to see in the census that reflected. But they got to the point where they're not worth anything now. And so I'm sure they're starting to trickle down. There's fewer and fewer people. Say, well, no one will buy them off me, why would I breed them?
That's
and all I say to our members, if every member, we've got between 800 and 900 members, if every member had one pair and just bred one nest a year, they'd be safe. But yeah, they'll get down again and we'll probably have to do it again. But we've done the same thing now with four species. And so we've got a conservation fund that lets us buy foundation stock of species we want to focus on. So we've done it with the yellow siskin. We've done it with the Javan munia, which again, we almost lost because some idiots hybridised them with Bengalese. So it was really hard to get pure stock to start off with. And we're trying to do it with the rufous-backed manakin, but it's very hard to get young breeding stock of those. So we're going to have multiple programs like this that roll on and try and just get volunteers participating. But the key thing is we have one person who controls each program. They have to be a member of the QFS committee. We have no money involved. So all the volunteers get birds free, but they have to send them back, all the progeny. They can keep the birds they get, but no money. If you get money involved,
you'll
get stuff.
Yeah, I guess for New Zealand, we suffer from such a small population base ourselves.
Yeah.
So we've got maybe, 130 members?
Not quite, I don't
know. Somewhere, that's probably, that's like if everybody was doing stuff.
Yeah.
And of those 130, there might be 50 that maybe could, you know, and you get, and then you end up, there's probably only 10 that have facilities that are suitable for doing a program like that. And
we had dart though. We did it with the plum heads got down really
Well, you've done it with a few, haven't you? You've got the orange breasts, there's the plum heads.
Cordons.
Same problem though, not worth anything anymore. They don't breed them.
You need to just encourage people to keep birds that aren't worth anything. Like, they're all worth something. They're all great to keep.
They're obviously zebra finches are not worth a lot of money, but they people still keep them, so it must be possible. They're lovely birds, though. So, yeah, I just wondered about how, it's quite hard to translate what you did in Australia to New Zealand, because we've got such low numbers of people involved. And
then if you've got 10 people, you can do a lot with a species.
The other problem we have is old age too, not just the birds, but the owners are not getting at anybody.
That's true,
Jane. So yeah, like this.
It's getting younger people, encouraging them to come in.
Things to encourage young people, so anyone under 18 gets free membership of our society. We've got an aviary program now where we give a brand new aviary plus
birds,
accessories to anyone between 15 and 30. So each pack, the aviary and birds and things they get, is worth $1,500.
But isn't there a risk they don't, like, because it didn't cost them anything and that they just they died?
We require them to commit that they will keep and look after their birds for at least 3 years. If after 3 years they're not interested, we take it back.
Yeah.
The aviary remains our property.
That's good.
And so far, we haven't had any come back.
How long have you been doing that?
Oh, only just before the last convention, so about 3 years.
Yeah,
so
that's
gosh.
Right.
So we've got a donor who gave us a big swag of money to kick that off, which helped a lot. So we've got funds to do 10, and then he's going to give us money to do another 10. So we're doing those sorts of things. We sponsor juniors to the conventions to try and get juniors who are already keen, make sure we've got them for life.
Yeah.
And the key thing we want to do is get young people exposed. Like, we did a survey of our members and asked them, you know, we've got the age structure of our membership, so the average age is 50 to 60. But we asked them, when did you first start to keep birds? The average is 15. Right? That's when you got to get them. And then we know they'll drift out of birds, but they'll come back when they're 40. So you just got to get
so
that
true.
Interest early.
Yeah.
Once you hit 15, 16, birds become important, but just the non-feathered ones.
in
life and work. And
once you've got trapped your wife and you've got her in the kitchen, then you can go back to building aviaries. Is that what you're saying?
But I reckon there's a new... I heard this at Wairapa Bird Club as far as focusing on, not so much on the... All the focus today has been on the younger folk, you know, like... even less than 15 perhaps, you know, juniors. Whereas now they're saying, get the pre-retirees, get the ones in their 50s. To get a hobby going, which they can then take into their retirement and enjoy in retirement. And also they've got a few bob, usually.
Or do both.
Or disposable income.
Some.
Oh, it's just going to say that.
Yeah, you're right. You are right, actually. And I think, her daughter's 23 and not quite such a drain financially.
So
we're finding the spare money now to buy more things involving aviaries.
Because it is a great hobby, and it doesn't have to be too, you know...
It can be
a
small or big.
Setting up costs for aviaries and things like that, but once you're up and running, it's not a huge cost to keep things ticking over nicely.
You can more or less spend as much as you like.
That's right.
Our birds eat better than Bev and I.
You'll be right for a few days now, though. You've seen all the food that's there.
Thank you all, that's wonderful.
We'll just check your comfrey.
But I'd just like to... we've got some comfrey on that side planted if you wanted, but I'd like to thank Gary again for his time and knowledge that he shared with us. The contrast between keeping finches in Australia and New Zealand is black and white. But I would strongly recommend the QFS convention. If you go more than once, every time is different. Some people say, well, if you've been once, that's it, you don't need to go again. But every presentation is different. And myself, Gary, I have particularly enjoyed some of the presentations that you've had from people you brought across from England and from Europe and Canada. You had a very interesting chat from Canada one year. So anyway, thank you.
We had three international speakers every convention.
Yeah.
Is that every year, Gary? Or
every 3 years.
Every 3 years, right.
So 2020,
2020 is the next one.
And for people who want to get deeper into the vet side of things, there are always one or two vets giving seminars, which is useful. And I've only ever heard one criticism, and that was recently. I think the last time I was there, one or two people were saying, and I think they were QFS people, they were saying, just quietly, it's getting a bit scientific for some of us. But science and science is different. One presentation I particularly enjoyed, I think, was it Richard Zan?
Yeah, that was some years back
on the colour banding of zebra finches.
Yeah.
And he proved with experimental data that if you put a bright red ring on your zebra finches, their percentage of breeding was higher than if you put a black ring on.
Oh, yeah, because they were more colourful.
Red stockings, didn't
they? You know, it was like fishnet stockings on your zebra finch or something. So science can be quite entertaining.
Red socks.
Anyway, vote of thanks. Thank you, Gary.
Thank you, Gary.